I would like to take a few moments and just explain why I wrote the book and what the book is about, then we're going to have we will have the panel discussion with the two people that I'm very very pleased to have here with me. I want to thank the Abraham Lincoln Library for having me and hosting this. I want to thank Mark DePue for his efforts in promoting this event. I certainly want to thank Jim Durkin for taking time off from a very busy day and a very busy schedule to be here, and certainly Andy Manar, Senator Manar, for his commitment to come here. As you were just told, I was a lobbyist for about 37 years, and I worked for companies and I worked for industries, and I started my own firm about 20 years ago now, 17 years ago, but I like to tell people that somewhere along the way to today, I picked up a PhD, and I think if you sequence my DNA somewhere in there, you'll find an academic, and somewhere in there you'll find a historian. And when the Blagojevich arrest happened, I looked around, and I came over to the Capitol that day, and I looked around and I thought, you know, this is probably the most important thing that the Illinois legislature has ever faced in its almost 200-year history. And I thought, you know, I may want to do something with this someday. So I decided to go to every hearing, House hearing, the investigative committee hearings, and I attended every minute of the trial. I went to Senator Cullerton and I said, John, can I need a pass, because you had to have passes to get into the gallery, and it was very tightly controlled, for reasons that are just logistic reasons, but there was a tremendous interest, and there was also security concerns about this. And the Senate President said, well, I can't put you down as a lobbyist. And I said, well, put me down as a college professor. And he said, that'll work. So he gave me a pass. And I thought perhaps my doing something with this would be a journal article or two that I could do, because college professors are required to publish. And I realized after a few years that nobody had approached the 8 weeks between the time he was arrested and the time he got off the plane at Midway Airport, and they said, you're no longer governor. There have been Blagojevich books, about three of them that I can recall, but no one ever talked about the legislature and what the legislature did. And so I decided I'm going to write a book. And that was about 3.5 years ago. And what I wanted to do was to create something that was written in a way that would be appreciated as academic rigor, that someone could use in doing research, but also I wanted to create an interesting read for the general public. I wanted something 100 years from now that a young person could go to a library and get this book and be right there and to see what I saw and to feel what I felt, and the reactions of the people in the crowd or in the audiences, the various hearings and at the trial. And so I took that approach with the book, and I hope that I've accomplished it, and I hope when you read it, that's the reaction you'll have. It's very accurate. The reason that it's very accurate is because everybody is still alive. And if you say, I didn't say that, or I wasn't, that didn't happen. I interviewed over 60 people, including the Speaker of the House and the Senate President and the House Prosecutor. I spent 6 hours with going over everything. And I think that I've covered. I had only two people, and I won't say who they are, who would not talk to me. They probably wouldn't be very happy if they did talk to me. So that was my idea with this book, and I hope that I've accomplished it. I hope it's the beginning of scholarship examination of what the legislature did, because like science, like in anything, in, you make progress by people contributing to work that is already in existence. And so this is the legislator's story. It's the story of those staff people that were so important in putting this together and doing this very, very difficult thing of impeaching a governor, of overriding the sovereign people's will as expressed through the election. They were going to override that. And that is a very, very heavy burden on everybody. But the staff people just contributed, and then they went on in just as normal business, and I think, frankly, they did a wonderful job. I want this book to be a story of what those staff people and the legislature did during those 7 weeks and 3 days. I think we'll begin talking about it and question and answers afterwards, Mark, and I think I think that's all I want to say in the opening remarks, but I think you'll find it interesting, very interesting.
Thank you, Bernie. I'm going to take just a couple minutes very briefly to introduce each one of our panel members again, just to kind of put a marker on the wall, and start with Leader Jim Durkin, House Minority Leader, born in 1961 in Chicago, grew up in the suburb of Westchester, a family of eight boys. That tells you something right there, and as the name does, I think. Undergraduate degree from Illinois State, a law degree from John Marshall School of Law. Jobs include Cook County State's Attorney. In 1995, you began your career as a legislator from the 44th District in Westchester. Stepped out in 2002, came back in. I guess there was an election in there you might not want to talk about tonight.
I'm trying to forget about it.
Yeah.
Very forgettable year for the Republican Party, 2002. There's a number of events.
Yeah. 2006, you were again elected, or I guess appointed at one time, for the 82nd District, Western Springs, so not too far away from your roots. And in 2013, you had the honor of being selected as the leader of the Illinois House. Senator Andy Manar, born in 1975 in Macoupin County, grew up in Bunker Hill, and understand you still live there.
I do.
Yeah. BA from Southern Illinois in Edwardsville, plus a teaching certificate, which is certainly important to what you're working on right now. Working career includes city councilman, Macoupin County chair, and then somewhere along the line, Senator Vince DiMizio got a hold of you.
That's right.
I understand you became an intern, deputy chief of staff for the Senate President Emil Jones. There's probably some stories there somewhere down the road. And chief of staff for John Culleton before you ran and won an election in 2013. And for our distinguished author tonight, Dr. Bernard Sieracki. But I don't know that anybody calls you that, do they?
No, no one calls you that.
And, well, let's just say, Bernie, you were born sometime before these two gentlemen were.
thank you, Mark.
BA from Roosevelt University in history. You wanted me to point that out. PhD from UIC, Circle Campus, in public administration. And your working career, you began with Congressman Ed Derwinski. There's quite a few people here who probably remember that name or recognize it. Ran your first campaign in 72, became a lobbyist sometime after that, 36 years as a lobbyist. And then in 2010, you kind of stepped away from that and began a full-time teaching career. And the thing I want to mention about Bernie, he and I had talked about this a couple times before. He was the right guy with the right skill set, the academic background, all those years in the legislature with all those contacts, to do what you were talking about, to preserve what's probably the most important piece of Illinois political history and our living memory, if not for the entire history of the state. So we're thrilled to have you all here, gentlemen, and the way we're going to go from here is I will start, just ask some questions. I'll probably direct it to an individual, But the more this is a conversation between the three of you, I think the better as we go along. So you don't have to wait from the speaker to have permission to talk and just jump right in, if you will. And here's an easy one for you. And I'm going to start with Leader Durkin on this. If you would, what are your memories of when you first heard the news about Rod Blagojevich being arrested in December 9th, 2008?
I was in bed. And it's in the book. And my wife got up before me and she yelled over. He said, "You got to get in here and watch this." And I'm like, it was the news. It was governor had just been arrested. And I'm like, holy Christ, this was the beginning of December. And I'm like thinking, good God, what's going to become of this? And I'm just watching this and just seeing the news reporting upon a sitting governor being hauled out of his house in handcuffs, brought over to the federal lockup over on Roosevelt Road, being detained for a bond hearing later in the afternoon. It was very surreal. Is probably the only way I can describe it. It was one of the most surreal moments in my life. And, you know, I think people sometimes have these moments where they know exactly where they were when something really dramatic has happened. I remember I grew up in a West Side Irish family. We all, you know, brothers, Democrats, independents, but, you know, I remember when the late Mayor Daley passed away. I remember exactly where I was. I was in a basketball court. We stopped the game. And I can think of a few other situations, but watching Blagojevich, a person who I served with back in the early 90s, sitting governor of this great state, being hauled off in handcuffs, to me it was surreal. It was sad. But it also made me think we probably got some work ahead of us, too. Within an hour, I received a phone call from the Minority Leader Tom Cross, indicated that he had, I believe, had a communication with the Speaker, is that we're going to start considering an impeachment process. And it was just, but please be quiet about this. We're going to have a special session. And I just let the process take its place. But again, you know, I'm looking at the picture of this guy over here, Blagojevich, and somebody who I knew back in the Illinois House of Representatives, and it was just unbelievable how he became the person who we all got to know during the trial and the impeachment. And it's just a very sad commentary in a very dark period of Illinois history.
You weren't at all happy to hear the news?
No. I don't like to hear bad things about state government or the state of Illinois. We're hearing a lot about it lately. Kind of getting used to it, which is not good. But I don't like it. I don't like this. I think this is not something that I'm happy about. I had a responsibility and a role to play in the House. It was my obligation. It was a duty. But having to go through this, I take no great pleasure.
Senator Manar.
You know, what I remember most about that day was the day became very heavy. It became a heavy day in the Capitol from a staff perspective. We were going through a transition in the Senate in leadership. The Senate President, President Cullerton, hadn't been elected yet because the new General Assembly hadn't been organized. President Jones was still in office, which presented a challenge immediately for not just the members of the Senate, but the staff of the Senate, because many of those changes hadn't even begun to play themselves out. I was a little surprised, to be honest. Not surprised that the arrest actually happened, but that, as the leader said, that the governor was actually arrested. That, you know, a sitting governor was arrested by federal law enforcement. You know, just immediately in the Capitol building, I think, you know, sent the obvious shockwaves through the place. But, you know, for us at the Senate, that set into motion just immediate things. It began an immediate conversation with the House, you know, with the leadership in the House. But it also added to what was a stretch of several weeks that Bernie writes about, to what is undoubtedly already a pretty pressure-filled situation. How do you elect a Senate president, which we know in Illinois in the past hasn't always worked out so well? You know, how do you layer this on top of all that, knowing that the governor who had been arrested is in charge of the Senate until it's organized? That's the first thing that came forward kind of in our minds was the Constitution provides. The governor presides over the Senate until a Senate president is elected. And those two things had a pretty severe collision in the Senate right away.
Bernie, do you want to weigh in on that question?
Just, well, when it happened, I went over to the Capitol. And just went over to the Capitol. I was interested to see what was going on. And as I said in the opening remarks, I realized how momentous this event was in the state. And it was a very eerie, I can describe the Capitol scene. It was very eerie and quiet. And people were walking around and not talking very much. And I looked into the governor's office on the second floor, and it was empty. And it was just, and Jim uses the word that is used by so many people when they describe the events of the arrest, and that's surreal. In fact, I used the word so much that my editor said, "You got to get another word. This is going on, and everybody's saying this." And I said, "Well, so, but that's exactly what it was." And my reaction was as an observer. I mean, I knew what was happening, and I knew how important it was, and I thought, I just want to soak this in as much as I can.
Well, the next question I have for the two legislators we've got here is, looking back on this, at that point in time, what you thought was the most important or the most damaging charge that was levied against Governor Blagojevich. And Bernie, you can help me out if I get something wrong here. I think it would be helpful, especially for the audience, just to run through them very quickly. This will only take a minute. Criminal charges, the attempt to sell President-elect Obama's Senate seat. That seemed to be in the top of the public's mind, at least. The attempt to fire members of the Chicago Tribune editorial board, trying to extort some money. And then a whole slew of other pay-to-play kind of allegations. One that seemed to really get a few people's crawl was the Children's Memorial Hospital. Balmoral Park was another, but I'm sure you guys can remember several more. So those are the criminal charges and nature of that. And then there was, not sure I'm going to get this right, but malfeasance and maladministration kind of charges that much of it can stem from the Auditor General's report, and much of it also stemmed from disagreements between JCAR, the Joint Committee on Administrative Rules, and the governor's office, where a lot of cases seemed like he was taking the prerogatives of the legislature and going far beyond that. And specifically, the family care program, the purchase of flu vaccines, the iSave RX, the drug from Canada program. And did I get pretty right there, Bernie?
You got pretty right. I think the important thing to realize is that, and this is where the title of the book comes from, the Illinois Constitution of 1970 only says for cause. There's no criteria. There's no high crimes and misdemeanors. There's none of that. It says for cause. And one of the delegates to the Constitutional Convention of 70, a fellow named Ron Smith, told me that that's what they wanted to do. They didn't want to get involved with impeachment. They just wanted to leave that up to the legislature and make it a political thing. That's what Ron said. So the legislature was faced with, okay, we have one word, cause. And the consequences of doing what they were doing were enormous. And so and it's also important to remember that the day he was arrested, there were no criminal charges yet. There was a complaint, but he was not indicted. So what do you do? And so this is the genius of the legislature for those 7 weeks and 3 days. They cobbled together a cause by using the administrative misdeeds that he had done. And they were many. And they could be documented. They were real because they were the result of Auditor General reports and complaints, and also the Z. Scott, the Inspector General. So that's what they immediately, and I said, now they had these, this information. And I said to David Ellis at the time, I said, David.
And he was?
He's the House prosecutor. And I said, and also ran the investigating committee. And I said, you're either the most brilliant lawyer that has ever served in Illinois, that you could put these charges together in 6 days, or you were working on it before. And he said, and the speaker told me, yeah, we were working on it before. So the administrative functions, the administrative charges, were developed before the arrest. And the arrest was basically the trigger that said go, we go. And then they added on in the impeachment resolution, finally, the final resolution, they added on some of the allegations, some of the criminal allegations, which at the time were not charges yet. They were just what they said in the criminal complaint.
No, but the thing is, we're not guided by anything, and what we had to work with was nothing. There's absolutely no precedent for this in the United States. And so, as Bernie said, it's accurate that, and I found out that the House Democrats, clearly there was a disconnect between the Speaker and the Governor, and they, based on these administrative malfeasance, you want to call it, were building up a case for impeachment, specifically for the actions he was doing, whether it was doing an end around on JCAR and all the other things that we talked about, but this is what was the tipping point. But they were ready, and they had found out that Dave was the chief counsel in the House on the House Investigative Committee, had performed, I think, had done a lot of research about exactly how would a process go about in Illinois if we got to that stage. So he's a friend, he's a good lawyer. They had a lot of that stuff in place. But we found out it was only within a few days after the arrest that we're going to have to embark upon this process. In which I got the call from Tom Cross just the day before we authorized a resolution in the House to that I would ask if I would serve as the ranking member on the committee. So it was a combination of just looking throughout the you know, we looked at the Bill Clinton proceedings about how that worked. We looked at, I think, in the state of Arizona there was an impeachment, and there were a few other things. We were trying to find a mix. Now, remember, the Constitution just says we have to find cause. We're not required to find probable cause. We're not required to provide due process or any process. We just have to find cause. So, but I took the attitude, and you know, we all agreed that one, if we're going to go on this, embark on this journey, we're going to have a lot of people watching us, and this is going to be history. And we can do the easy thing. And I had some members on the committee who said, why don't we just get this done, pass a resolution? This was on the first day of the hearing, and just get this bum out of here, which we could have.
Yes.
But, you know, but he had a pretty good lawyer, person I've tried cases against, Ed Johnson, who's a very prominent lawyer in Chicago, kept talking about the fact that you guys don't have any process, and I could take this to the federal court, I can get some injunctive relief, or I'll take this as far as up as I can. And I'm like, well, you might. Mm-hmm. But the fact is, it was important for us to have a process in place, and that we did in a process which would allow the governor the ability to be afforded some process, not necessarily due process, but such as we're going to give the opportunity to call witnesses before this committee. We're not required under the Constitution to do that, but we're going to give you that opportunity. We're going to give you every opportunity to make your case. We're going to allow for you to seek perhaps the ability to subpoena a witness who is no longer, doesn't want to cooperate. So I felt that under the rules, and there's a few other things, that the more, the greater ability we could give the governor to make his case, that we need to protect and to preserve a strong record if on that long shot there was going to be a challenge in a court. And so we afforded them every opportunity. I mean, bring all your witnesses in. There was at one point, I remember one of the days, said, well, Ed Jensen said, we've got 20 witnesses lined up. I said, great, knock yourself out, bring them in. But the fact is, and you know, I don't want to jump too far ahead, but the fact is he was afforded every opportunity to make his case before the investigative committee on whether or not the allegations which we had presented, which we are going to vote on at some point, make a decision collectively as a group, of whether or not there's any truth to them or not. But he chose not to participate. And we also know that this is not a criminal proceeding. It's a kind of like a quasi-administrative civil proceeding, but the fact is you can draw an inference. If somebody, if they are refused to participate, you know, he's going to say that, you know, even if he wants to take the Fifth Amendment, I can't recall if he never took it, but
never took it.
But the fact is his failure to participate, and he was asked repeatedly to participate. We could use that as a negative inference against the governor, and we can use that as part of making our record and putting that into our case. So, but again, just to get back to where I first started with, it was a process which we had no process, but we had to put together something which was already worked on, but what we agreed upon. Republicans and Democrats, a process in place, because people will write about this. This is maybe a template for the future, but let's make sure that the most we're a country that is built on some process. We're going to give someone who is, if we're going to reverse a popular election, let's give this man his day in court. Give him that opportunity. We can't force him in, but make your case, and he chose not to.
But Leader, you did almost said due process, and you backed off on that because this isn't a criminal hearing. No. And I guess the question in that respect, and it's discussed in the book, why the sense of urgency that you didn't want to go down that road? Is clearly Barbara Flynn Curry didn't want to go there either, and there was some kind of agreement between the two parties that was not the approach you're going to take?
Again, your question is whether or not we were going to allow greater process.
Yes,
because we weren't required to. But the fact is, if we were going to go through a set up a, you know, if we were going to do a true due process right for the governor, it's going to take the same stage as a trial that we have, whether it's in a federal court or in a state court. We didn't feel that was appropriate. It would take months. They could drag it out. We didn't know exactly what that would mean if we were going to afford due process, but it would afford them more opportunities to than we believe were necessary under the circumstances. But to me, if you've been, you know, you have your life facing you, your career, and there's a group of people who under the Constitution have the right to strip you of that authority, it's not due process, but I tell you what, it's as close to due process as you can get for what our rules provided for the governor to be able to present before the House, the impeachment committee, which I likened in the book to kind of like a grand jury. The grand jury is one who collects evidence. Grand jury is the one that will swear out a bill of particulars or different charges within an indictment. But that was a similar role. I mean, our job was to collect evidence. Let's put together and make a good record, take a vote, send it over to the Senate. But educating members of the House also that, you know, even though there is an impeachment, it doesn't mean that he's out of office. And I think a lot of people didn't understand that. They hear impeachment, they think the minute that we impeach Rod Blagojevich, he's out. The fact is, there's a trial that has to go on in the Senate, and that's what Senator Manar was involved in.
And just when he was arrested, the governor basically had three options. He could resign. He could say, "I've got so much, I'm so emotionally distraught over this. I'm going to step down temporarily, and Lieutenant Governor will serve while I can gather myself, or he can face an impeachment." And the speaker said to David Ellis that morning, in 6 days, the delegates are going to come down here from the election that had just completed and cast their vote for Barack Obama at the old state capitol. So everybody will be here 6 days later. He was arrested on a Tuesday. They were going to be here on a Monday. And he said to David Ellis, we'll give him 6 days to pick one of those options so we know what's going on. And David said, should I get ready? And the speaker said, well, I think that'd be a pretty good idea. So.
Well, the notion that Governor Blagojevich would be able to appoint a United States Senator also is to move things along a little quickly, too. So,
yeah, right. Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's why we moved in, I think, in a very expeditious way.
Yes. Yeah.
So, Senator Manar, you're not a senator at the time, but certainly one of the senior staffers. From your perspective, now you've got from the House this list of charges. What was your sense in your own mind, but also in the minds of the senators themselves, the ones that seemed to carry the most weight?
Well, I think, you know, I wasn't the chief of staff either. going back to my first comment, we were kind of in limbo in the Senate. Leadership was changing. You know, President Jones was cooperative with the incoming presumed Senate president. So I wasn't the chief of staff until the day President Cullerton was sworn in. But, you know, going back to the cause issue, I think one of the most important documents, you know, you think of all the documents that went through the hands of members and that came over from the House, you know, the boxes of paper, things that were presented in the Senate trial, all of the pieces of paper and the research. I think the most important piece of paper that was used by the Senate was a memo that was created by Eric Medeer, who was the chief counsel for the Senate, that explained what Leader Durkin just went through. Because not only did that, I think, weigh heavy on members in terms of impeachment, but then the question of removal. You know, what threshold has to be met to undo, you know, completely undo an election? And that memo outlined that. And that, I think, was the most important document that was produced at the Senate, because it explained it in very clear terms that this is it's a political exercise. And that's what it was described as, and that's what it was. But, you know, at the same time, you know, we were preparing for the moment when still Governor Blagojevich would gavel the Senate in for the new General Assembly, knowing that all of these things were unfolding in the House.
So I just wanted to add one more, and I'm sorry for interrupting, but I think we can speak just freely here. But, one, you know, as I said earlier, I think our job was a fact-finding role in the House, and particularly in the committee, because after we moved the impeachment resolution out of the House, I mean, it kind of closed out the evidence. So one of the things that was very interesting is that we wanted to make sure that we had enough other than hearsay. We use all the hearsay we want. We did it in the hearing process, but we wanted to try to see how much direct, really solid evidence we can get. We have testimony about the administrative flaws that he had, but the actual criminal charges was important. And we just had a document that just said so-and-so, that he committed certain acts of extortion against Children's Memorial Hospital, and the list goes on. We had done some research in our side, and we realized that under very limited circumstances, and now Rod Blagojevich, I mean, there was newspaper articles over the fact that he had conversations that were taped, that the federal government had approved, intercept to be able to capture communications between him and other individuals, cooperating individuals, and also on the telephone. Under the federal rules of evidence, there's a limited opportunity for the federal government to disclose those intercepts based on a court order if it is in the furtherance of an investigative or another law enforcement agency. So we asked the U.S. Attorney's Office to petition the Chief Judge of Chicago, Holderman, and to make a case that we needed to build this case up. We wanted to send the best case we can over to the Senate. And we think that we would be able to tie it up in a nice bow, at least as much as we can with the evidence possible, by getting the transcripts from the overhear that was that led to the arrest of Rod Blagojevich, which was part of the probable cause warrants that we found out, we showed later, that were sworn out by the federal court months before. And after, it was an expedited process, but the court agreed to release those documents. We didn't use them in the House, but we wanted to make sure when they got over to the Senate, they were going to be able to use that in the trial. And there was, and I thought it was very, it was strong evidence. It was sworn under oath, and it was by the agent in charge. And it was, the agent actually portrayed himself. He was one of the characters. I mean, they played it out. Dave Ellis asked him questions. It was just about what was in the transcript. So. Again, I'm kind of jumping around a little bit, but I just want to tell you that we did a lot of work in the House to be able to present a good case. On a daily basis, we were on the call with the United States Attorney, Patrick Fitzgerald, discussing exactly every aspect of the case, who we would like to bring in and testify. We would, because we made an agreement at the beginning of this process with the U.S. Attorney that we were not going to do anything to disrupt their ongoing investigation, because it was not just limited to Rod Blagojevich at that time. And the last thing you want to do is get on the bad side of the U.S. Attorney and the FBI. So we on a daily basis, a call with Pat Fitzgerald and his people about witnesses and process. And I think that we in a very short amount of time. It was like drinking out of a fire hose, but the fact is it was right around Christmas, too. Sure. We had calls on Christmas Eve with Barbara Flynn Curry, myself, and also, because, you know, we didn't take a break from this stuff. But we put together, I think, as good as we can with no direction other than what we thought was the best way to handle a very delicate but a very important situation that the state of Illinois was confronted with.
Do you have something to...
No, go ahead.
Leader Durkin, here's another one for you, more focused on the House side. What did you think of Ed Jensen's attempts to defend Governor Blagojevich?
Well, he has an obligation as a lawyer to present his client in the most favorable light. But the fact is, I know Ed Jensen, he didn't have much of a case. But the thing is, he didn't bring any witnesses in. He didn't present any testimony or any documents. He didn't bring his client in. And you can't just say that a lawyer in itself. I mean, with a lot of this stuff, we have to consider the weight of the testimony or the evidence that's brought into us. But the fact is, just hearing Mr. Jensen say that this is a rigged proceeding, there's no process, I'm going to go to the federal court, and was challenging a lot of our, and he had the right to cross-examine, and we gave him the opportunity to cross-examine anybody who testified before the committee. But I think he was left in a very untenable situation. When you don't have a client that's going to cooperate or is going to give you anything to work with, he can do the best he can to be able to try to chop up the proceedings on what, with the witnesses that had been brought in by the, to testify before the committee. I remember this one specific situation, because if he did make a point or two, our job was to try to rebut it. Let's see if we can do to mitigate anything that he could have, caused. So he raised a situation that, and we talked about the whole idea of getting the wiretaps, that there is some validity, there is integrity to it. It's a very, very long, drawn out process. You have to go through multiple layers within the Department of Justice to be able to get the individual who oversees that in DOJ out in Washington to sign off on one of these overhears. And Ed Jensen said, it's kind of like a joke. You know, anybody can get that. I mean, you know, so there was really anybody, he really just downplayed it. And I'm like, that's not right. So I come from a family of lawyers. I have a brother that was a federal prosecutor advising the committee, but I also was friends with a gentleman who had just retired from the U.S. Attorney's Office, but he was on the Organized Crime Strike Force, and that was what he did his whole career. And I talked to him at length about the process of whether or not Ed Jensen said that this is just basically, don't read anything into it. Anybody can get this type of order authorized. So I spent an afternoon putting on John Scully, who's now a judge up in Lake County, going through the process of how you go about getting a DOJ authorized wiretap. So when Jensen, I tried to make a couple points. All right, let's see what we can do to try to rebut that, because everything, again, is going into a record that's going to go over to the Senate. So that's one thing that I remember about Jensen, just kind of dismissing the integrity of what we were trying to, because what was in the wiretaps were part of what was in some documents which we received a little bit later. So it was just trying to tie up the knot to say that, you know what, you can say that this getting this wiretap, it may not, to you, is important, but the fact is we have something else to show that this is not something that's taken lightly. And
I just add, it's important to understand what Jensen was going through. Jensen was hired a day or two before the investigative committee started, and throughout the as it progressed, two things were pretty apparent: that as a client would not listen to a word he said, and he was being replaced by other people on the defense team. And Eddie came in to, and Ed had no idea about the administrative charges that were going to be brought out. And so what he tried to do was to make the hearings as much as of a court procedure as he could possibly do. He would call the chairman, Chairman Barbara Curry, Your Honor. And he would call members of the panel jury. And he would try to set that scene so that people began to think that they were that the proceedings were covered by proceedings in a court, and they weren't. They weren't. Now, they tried as much as possible, or at least they tried to project as much as possible, that they were overcompensating for the lack of procedure. But in fact, so Eddie, by the time the hearings were over, his client was not even returning his phone calls. So if you can imagine, this is the attorney representing the governor, and the governor won't even return his phone calls. Was taking other advice. He was deciding that he would go on national television and become a celebrity, and his wife would go down to Belize and eat bugs, and he would do, and the advice, and the advice, and this is what Ed told me, was, look, we're going to make you a national celebrity because O.J. Simpson and Robert Blake Beretta were charged with murder, and they both were exonerated of that. And so we're going to make you, just like them, we're going to make you a celebrity. And guess what? Even if they impeach you, you can go to Indiana and run for public office and still be, and this is shocking, the back of my hair went up when he told me this, you can still be president of the United States. Now that's the mindset that the client had. And so Jensen was, I mean, he's here, he's a tremendous, I mean, he's Perry Mason. I mean, he comes in a motorized scooter, and he's a star and a celebrity, and I hope everyone in this room never has to use him, but he is good. And you can imagine just getting this job and then suddenly just your influence just diminished.
Or Bernie, you know, to the governor of Indiana option, the other option was you could appoint yourself to the United States Senate.
That's exactly right.
Right?
And that was part of the consideration, I know.
Yeah. Yeah. Bleeping golden, right? Was that the,
Bernie, a question for you then. Did Jensen decide to resign as his lawyer? Was he fired?
No, he
wasn't. The situation?
It was that he was kind of replaced and then just resigned later on. And during the trial, I mean, he had, during the Senate trial, Ed Jensen had no contact at all with Blagojevich.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about the Senate trial, because so far the focus has primarily been on the House side and the impeachment process. And it's obvious that impeachment process, how you're going to go through it, was critical to this whole experience. But once it got to the Senate, and you had the specific charges that Ellis and the House team had put together, how important was it to actually hear the tapes? There is a select number of tapes that you got from the U.S. Attorney's Office, from Fitzgerald. How important was it for the senators to hear Blagojevich's voice?
I would say it was very important. I think not just that piece, but I think every piece. I think the approach in the Senate was very heavy. I use that word again because it was a pretty clear-cut, set of actions on the part of the House, and it comes over to the Senate, which the question becomes, what do you do with this? And I think from the perspective of members at the time, which I was not, but discussions in caucus and discussions among members, it was important to hear everything, from beginning to end, not just the tapes, but every bit of evidence that was produced by the House. And it was interesting. There was, there were some members who deliberately ignored what was happening in the House, not because they weren't doing their duty, but they viewed themselves as a very much a jury, that's going to make a very, very difficult decision. And there were members who went to the House hearings, for example, on the other side of the spectrum. But that's why I think it was, it was important to hear everything, and that's what we did. And those members that tried to stay away from news accounts, tried to ignore the media, tried to ignore some of, everything that was going on the national news level at the time, they wanted to hear it for the first time in totality, that, in their view, would help them make that decision, a very big decision.
Well, of course, the climax of this whole process, and especially what's happening in the trial itself, is when the governor finally does come and make his case. So for all of you, but I'm going to start with you since you were in the Senate at the time, your impressions of Governor Blagojevich and that, 45-minute presentation he made to the Senate?
I thought he did a pretty good job, to be honest with you. I hope that nobody doesn't not vote for me in the future because I said that. But, He had nothing with him. I mean, he brought nothing with him to the Senate. You know, Bernie talks about this in the book, but I'm convinced that day that he wasn't aware of the full magnitude of what was happening, you know, just a floor up from his office, and what had taken place in the Senate chamber for, you know, multiple days. I don't know why he wouldn't be aware.
How could he not be aware?
I don't know. I don't. But then you ask the question, why would someone think that in a position that he was in, he could actually appoint himself to the United States Senate? But you know, when he walked out on the Senate floor, he didn't have anything with him. You know, he might have constructed some things in his mind, but you know, I think being an attorney by trade, I think he was ready to go. And you know, from talking to many members of the Senate, I think they were quite surprised at the defense he made for himself. I think most were surprised that he actually came, that he you know, filed that motion to come and appear, but I think the presentation that he made was very different than what most people expected.
Different in what respect?
Different in that, you know, and this is a little bit of a paradox, but at a time when I don't think he understood the gravity and the, you know, the level of involvement of what was happening and what could potentially happen to him, he sure did, you know, present a case to defend himself. I don't think it swayed anybody, right? But I think people were surprised by how he presented himself to the Senate that day.
That's an interesting part of this whole book. And I'll be very honest with everyone. I was about a month away of turning the book over to the publisher, and I went to John Cullerton's office in Chicago. And there was one thing that was bothering me, and I said, "Mr. President, the day before the last days, someone called you and said the governor wants to appear tomorrow." And I said, Catherine's the secretary, came out and gave you a note to call. Who was that?" And John Cullerton said, "I can't remember." And I said, "Oh, this is one of the most important events of your life and you can't remember?" He said, "No, I can't remember." So we got Andy on the phone, on the speakerphone, and Andy couldn't remember. Now, I've been a lobbyist for a few years, so I thought, well, wait a minute. So I went to Catherine, his secretary, John's secretary, and I said, "Who was this guy?" And she said it was one of two people, a fellow named Alan Stolve, who was an attorney on staff with the governor's office, or it could have been Clayton Harris. And Alan Stolve was in Switzerland, so that doesn't make my access to him very easy. I called Clayton Harris. I had never met Clayton Harris. And I told him who I was, and I told him what I was doing, and I said, "Would you talk to me?" And he said, "Yeah." I said, "Would you talk to me on tape?" "Yeah." I thought, "Oh my God." So I went to Chicago, and we met, turned on the tape, and he gave me the view from inside the staff, what was happening inside the staff. The governor's staff. Clayton Harris was a gentleman that came from a different agency, I believe transportation, and was with the governor for a matter of months. He was assistant chief of staff, had the same name as John Harris, had the same last name, and was not involved in any of this stuff. And suddenly the governor's arrested and he's acting chief of staff, and that night, so they met in the president's office after the third day was over with. Andy was there, and several senators, John Cullerton, Clayton Harris, and Alan Stolve. And how do you let him come before the Senate now? He decided not to participate in the trial. And every time the Chief Justice would say, "Is the governor here? Is there counsel for the governor?" "No, nothing." So now at this late date, by the Senate rules, how do you let this guy come in? And by the way, he wants to come in not under oath. So Eric had the idea that we will grant him leave. We still stay in control and we can stop this at any time while he comes in. So they, through the night, they notified, Eric Madeira notified everybody that that it was okay. The day of, the last day, Andy was still not convinced that, if I may tell this story,
sure.
Andy was convinced, not convinced that he would show up. So he checked with DOT, Department of Transportation, and yes, a plane took off. And yes, the governor was on it. That was all. Senate President and Andy and Eric Madeira had talked. Who's going to go get him when it's time for him to come up here? Because certainly John Cullerton was not going to go get him. Eric Madeira, he didn't know Eric. Eric had come from the House. It was in private practice. Senator Manar had worked with the governor previously on the budget, if I'm getting that correct.
Not for the governor.
Not for, but with the governor. with the governor. As a Senate point man for the budget. And so they decided that Andy would be the person to go get him because he knows you and he'll be more comfortable. And so Andy Manar went to get him. The Chief Justice says, well, go get the governor. And do you want to tell the story or do you want me to tell
it? Go ahead. You do it.
Andy gets... if you can imagine, the elevators are blocked off with yellow tape. And so the only way to get down to the governor's suite, that one flight down, is through the stairs. And so he goes down the stairs and gets to the governor's suite, and he opens the door, and nobody is there. Nobody. And he looks around. There's no secretaries. There's no staff people in the office. There's nobody there. And he looks in the conference room. If you've ever been to the governor's conference room, it's a paneled, small paneled room, nobody there. Goes out and meets this fellow and says, and the fellow says, what do you want? Or something like that. And Andy explains who he is, and he's coming to get the governor because the governor's got to go upstairs. So he takes Senator Manar back and says, wait here in the conference room. And by the way, when I wrote this book, I did not check what I wrote with anybody except Andy Manar, because I couldn't make this up. And I said, you've got to tell me this is correct. And now, if you can imagine, everybody is upstairs waiting. The gallery is completely full. The senators are sitting there, and it's silent for a long period of time. Just silent. Nobody's talking on a cell phone. Nobody's, nothing. Rod Blagojevich suddenly comes, and I don't use these words in the book, but he was comes bopping by, completely oblivious to what's happening, and goes in and says something to the effect of, Andy, what are you doing here? And Senator Manar said, Andy Manar said, I've come to get you. We have to go upstairs. And he said something to the effect of, go upstairs? Why do I have to go upstairs? He was confused. And then kind of dawned on him. This is the bizarre behavior that's going on. He said, well, come here for a minute. So takes Andy back to his office.
The big office, yeah. Large
and
office. Yeah.
The large office. And just then, a few minutes later, an entourage of people come in. And by the way, I verified this with Clayton Harris, because Clayton Harris was a part of that entourage. And says, so they all start talking and telling jokes. And Senator Manar is looking at his watch and figuring, I've got to get this guy upstairs. Everybody's waiting. Says to the effect, we've got to go, Governor. Governor says, give me a few minutes. Goes in the bathroom, right across from the governor's desk. There's a bathroom right to the right, I believe. And by the way, Andy Manar and I walked the steps, so I know this is correct. And governor's in there for about 5-10 minutes, combing his hair. We don't know. And suddenly the door flies open, and the governor takes off and starts running towards the back stairwell to go up to the third floor, running. and the entourage runs after, including Andy Manar. And on the stairwell, finally gets the governor, stops him, and begins telling him the procedure when he gets to the Senate floor, where don't go up to the podium up on top because the Chief Justice is up there. We've got a place for you in front. And by the way, these people can't come on the floor. And the governor says something to the effect of, she can, and he points to this woman, she can. And he said, no, nobody can come on the floor. And the governor said, this is personal. And so there was a words exchange. And finally, Senator Manar, Andy Manar at the time, says, I got to get this guy to the floor. Okay. They take a few steps, and he looks down, and she's got a press pass. And I can only imagine what you were thinking. Like, I let this person on the floor from this news outlet, but everybody else can't go on the floor. They're going to kill me if I do this. So it's more words. Eventually, the governor agreed that the woman doesn't come on the floor. And they go in the back of the Senate. There's a hallway there. And they walk down, and people are speaking, and the governor just, but they walk down fairly quickly and quietly. And from the Senate hallway to the Senate floor is a small corridor. It must be 15, 20 feet, paneled on both sides, two doors, door to the hallway, door to the Senate chamber. They get in and close the door to the hallway, and Andy reaches for the, I'm telling you this wild story because it's reinforcing. He didn't really appreciate what was going on. Andy reaches for the door to open it, and the governor grabs his forearm and said, Andy, I'm innocent. I didn't do anything wrong. You should really be telling this story.
You're doing good.
And Andy looked at him and said, Governor, you don't have to convince me, pointing to himself. You have to convince those 59 people out there. And he opens the door, and Blagojevich walked past him and then gathered himself and gave the speech. The speech was a complete fabrication. He never addressed any of the charges. And what he gave was a campaign speech. It was effective in the sense that senators later told me that their home districts were getting telephone calls after that speech saying, don't convict him. He's an innocent man. He's fighting for the, you know, he had everything in this speech. It was instinct. It was political instinct that he gave the speech. As you said, he brought nothing with him.
Nothing. Yep.
And he went out there and he talked about the poor Hispanic lady. She was Hispanic, see? It's very intelligent. He's got Hispanic voters in that 59 people. And she was, you know, trying to figure out what, you know, her life, and it's cold outside, and you can feel the cold because it's winter, and she has to leave her children, and she tenderly kisses her children before she goes out, and it's still dark. I mean, this was a great performance. And it was accepted by the public, and this goes into why he was such a character and why he was not impeached beforehand, that he could sway public opinion, and he did with that speech. Several senators remarked, Senator Lichtenthal said, it doesn't get any better than that. And
Well, he knew that his life was in front of him. He's going to get indicted. He's going to be in front of a courtroom with a bunch of jurors from the Chicago area. So he's going to make the most passionate case about how he's been a sympathetic character who's been, misunderstood, and that he's done so much for every imaginable type, every demographic that could possibly.
Right.
I believe part of it was that he was setting himself up to have as sympathetic a jury pool that possibly can be. That will hear his case.
Let me go back one more thing. When after the meeting with Andy Manar and the other senators, Clinton Harris went back to the governor's mansion, and he's trying to write a speech. He was trying to write the speech for him for the next day, and he kept calling the governor's house and couldn't get through to the governor. Governor's wife said, "Well, he's watching TV now." And this really plays into what Andy was saying, that he had no idea or no grasp of what was happening. Then he called back and said, well, he's eating. And finally, he got on the phone. And he said, you want to say this, you want to say that. He said, now look, go to bed. Everything's going to be all right. I'm going to bed right now. And Harris looked at Ellen Stovey and he said, he's going to be thrown out of office tomorrow. And he's going to bed. You know, he's just completely disengaged to what's happening and what was reality. It was just completely couldn't grasp reality, or for some reason didn't grasp reality.
Can I
go ahead?
Please.
Comment about,
please.
That, yeah. About that morning. That morning, the morning when he appeared, you know, when he was removed. I think our mornings were starting at about 5:30 as a staff, and Eric and I met regularly. I think that was probably the third night he didn't go home in a row. And just to reinforce what you do in the book, Bernie, the work that the staff did was tremendous. It was tremendous on both sides of the aisle, and both the House and the Senate. And they took it seriously. They took their role seriously. They understood what was at stake and what the questions were before the legislature. But that morning, Justice Fitzgerald, I think my impression at the time was he was about done. I think he was ready for this thing to be over. And he gave us a hard deadline. He gave Eric and I, during our morning meeting with him, a hard deadline, because I don't think he was convinced either that the governor was going to actually show up before the Senate. And I don't remember the time, but that was what was on my mind the whole time, was balancing, you know, Justice Fitzgerald's, you know, direction that if he's not here by this minute, I'm moving on, with Eric Medeer's direction that we really have to get him in front of the Senate for legal reasons, many of which Leader Durkin laid out, you know, for the same purposes in the House, to build the case. And that's what was weighing on my mind, was if he doesn't get out there, I was convinced that if he walked into that corridor 4 seconds too late, that Fitzgerald was going to say, no thanks, get out of here. So I think we got there just under the gun, but that was important, you know, to have him there so he could defend himself.
Leader Durkin wanted to give you a little bit more chance to respond to your impressions of the actual speech that he gave. I assume you were.
Well, I was there. I was in the gallery. It was It was. He can be very convincing. He's. You know, you're dealing with a person who has a high degree of narcissism. A person maybe have some chemical imbalance going too through his head. I'm serious. I kind of smiled, but I mean, the way that he was operating, and he was complete denial, as the senator said, about what was actually happening. When you go home at night, you're watching day whatever it is, Blagojevich. I mean, it's national news, but I thought it was pretty. He did a heck of a job without any notes. He laid out a super case for something, but it wasn't about anything relating to the proceedings that were in the Senate. So, I'm like, all right, and the vote was interesting. A couple of people got their votes right. Kind of mixed up, but I just remembered. I mean, he's gone, you know, yeah. Whew, like that. You know,
yeah, we had a electronic malfunction.
Yeah,
we had electronic malfunction, yeah. Which of all times to have this happen, and it actually happened on the vote of the president of the Senate
when he
cast his vote,
which
we redid. Wow.
But you know, that night, you know. After the Senate had removed him from office, I mean, then you have the next phase of which, and I walked over to the House because the proceeding to swear in the lieutenant governor was just about to take place. So, you know, you can't have this, you know, a lapse in the governance in the state of Illinois. But again, I don't know what goes above surreal, but I just went through this process in the House. I watched the Senate. I was in the Senate for the governor's speech and then the vote, and then watching Pat Quinn get sworn in, and all in a matter of a day. It's just you can't make this stuff up. And but again, it's history, and I don't take any great joy in being there, but it was an obligation that we all had in that building to do something which we felt was right for people in this room and everybody through the state of Illinois who was not getting fair governance out of the person who was elected in the previous election. And I mean, you know, there's always little things that come up still. And people will talk about Blagojevich and periodically, and then there's always something new that shows up. I mean, and I remember certain, you know, whether it's Roland Burris having that little moment, you know, interchange with him in the House that was very interesting. And, you know, but there's just so many different side things that went on in this process. But what Bernie captured in the book was not what the sensationalism that the press was doing, but was what was going on in the committee and what was going on. He interviewed everybody about what we were doing outside the committee, with staff, with our lawyers, with our colleagues, people around the committees, and on a daily basis. And it was and I think it was as seamless as you could run a proceeding which you have no guidance on. There's no precedent. But our staff did a magnificent job, and I think every one of the legislature conducted themselves in a very professional manner, which sometimes can be a very big theater over there. But I think it was a very somber time in that building, in both the House and the Senate.
One of the things that typically goes on outside these meetings is people are counting votes for either of the House or the Senate. Was there any doubt in your mind how the vote was going to go down? I mean, it was only needed to be 50% in the House. Yeah. It's a pretty low bar in the House.
And no, never with us. No, there was never any doubt in the House, at least in the House Republican side. And there was, I think, two people, I think, voted.
One
voted. But and I'm not saying that we knew exactly where to vote, but...
Was Blagojevich's sister-in-law, right?
Right.
Yeah. So, I mean, he was not a sympathetic character, let's put it that way, to the legislature. But again, if you're going to snub your nose at the House of Representatives and dismiss what our legal duties were, again, it wasn't an the head count was pretty, it was pretty easy.
In the Senate?
You know, I don't think there was too much question.
The theory, though, was that that was the one place he did have allies going in.
And he did. And he did. And that was the result of the previous General Assembly, previous leadership. But you know, we encountered things along the way from people around him, for example, that would put out things like, well, he got impeached, and so that's his punishment enough. You know, maybe the Senate shouldn't remove. You know, those things, those types of conversations came up. But you know, after everything was presented in the manner in which it was, in the public setting, you know, being watched by the people of the state, there was no, I don't think there was any questions. Now, there were moments, though, I should say this, where, and this, I think, is more evidence of the gravity of what was happening, where there was no staff in the room with the members of the Senate. So when there was some, you know, deliberations, which were rare, I think, in the large scheme of things behind closed doors, because a bulk of what happened in the Senate was played out in public in full transparency. But there were times, rightfully so, where members, elected members of the Senate, the legislative branch of government, were by themselves. And that means myself and Eric Medeir, the chief counsel, and others were asked to leave. Mm-hmm.
They were a jury. They thought of themselves as a jury.
Well, in retrospect, then, this strikes me as a rare moment in Illinois history, and you can extend it out to American history as well, perhaps, in recent history, where there does seem to be a truly bipartisan effort. Was that the case? Is that accurate?
Senator, do you want to start?
I would say in the Senate, yes. I think, you know, it was, but again, going back to, there was a change in leadership. You know, Leader Redonio, President Cullerton, and there was an agreement early on between those two individuals, to their credit, that they wanted to do this the right way. And, you know, I give them equal credit for that. And, you know, there were a few moments, you know, there were, you know, closing statements where there was a little bit of, you know, partisan shouting. But that was overshadowed, I think, by what was undoubtedly a bipartisan effort in the Senate.
And in the House?
In the House, for the most part, it was. We worked in a very cooperative, very collegial manner. And like anything, you're going to have some disagreements. And there was some tension when, as I mentioned earlier, of why some people thought that we needed to bring Roland Burris in before the committee, which that was the one subpoena that we issued out of in the whole House Impeachment Committee was for Roland Burris, and I felt it was important, who had just accepted the appointment after other people had rejected it. And I had performed my diligence about campaign contributions and the connections, and I whole issue about Blagojevich was the issue of quid pro quo, and I'm like, allowing a person to go into the United States Senate from a very challenged individual, the Governor Blagojevich, and I felt it was important to get his testimony before the committee. And that, I will just say that the conversations I had with my colleagues were friendly, and they were like, whatever, fine. And then as it got closer to the day in which he stated he was going to testify before the committee, it got very tense. And there were words exchanged about what I was planning to do and how I was going to go about it. And that was kind of an interesting moment as it played out. But everything was fine, and things got a little bit challenging between the Republicans and Democrats of some affidavits that were submitted after the fact by Mr. Burris, which caused further just controversy, but I'll say that 99% of it was that we worked well, we took our job serious, we knew we had an obligation and a duty, and to do it in a professional manner, one in which we knew that people will look back in history, decide, was this the right thing to do, and the process upon which you came to your decisions, do we believe it complied with our Constitution and what we believe is important with our federal Constitution, which little or no guidance. But again, I started this whole thing out about we wanted to afford this man the opportunity to make his case, the strongest case he could, which we did not have to do, but we did.
Well, the time got past me here. It's so fascinating to hear these stories. But I do want to close with a couple questions and ask you to be very brief on this next question for the two representatives we have here. Are you proud of the role that you played in this experience and proud of your legislative body and how it went down? Senator Manar?
I'm incredibly proud, not just not that I take pride in what happened. You know, what happened was a terrible, terrible tragedy for the state. You know, it was a dark time. It was a difficult time, but I, as a staff member and the entire staff in the Senate on both sides of the aisle, along with their work for the elected part of the body, absolutely.
Leader Durkin.
Yes. Like the Senate, we worked extremely hard behind the scenes, but I gave you all the reasons and the things that we did, but it was a very thoughtful process, even though, look, nobody wanted to get rid of this guy, but the fact is we had to make our case. We could have done it real easily, as I said, on the first day of our committee hearing. But I was honored to be part of this, but I was extremely impressed with the levels of professionalism and also restraint. We had a very, 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 very challenging time in the state of Illinois, that members of the House of Representatives, how they conducted themselves in the committee, but also on the floor of the House of Representatives when we actually voted for the impeachment.
And Bernie, a little bit different kind of question for you. What hopes do you have for the future of the book?
Oh, well, I was joking with my wife the other day that if Blagojevich would only escape, that would help sales a tremendous amount. I hope that the book can be used in the classroom today, in law classes, evidence courses, or in political science courses, or even public administration and history courses. I hope it'll be used in the near future, is that it is used that way. And as I said in my opening remarks, I hope that 100 years from now, someone can read that book and be at that. Be in those hearings, be at that trial, and see what, and feel what I think we all expressed today.
Well, I'll have to tell you, reading the book myself here just recently, I was there. It drew me in. It's been a wonderful night. I want to thank our panel members and appreciate you all being here.